But in 1992, Lennart Johansson, the president of UEFA, the governing body of European football, was faced with a dilemma beyond his control.
This is something that I always will remember with sadness, because the Yugoslavian team has qualified already, and they were in Sweden, where the United Nations put a ban on them. And we have to obey to the decision being taken by the United Nations. That is in our statutes. There was no other alternative but to ask them kindly to step out, which they did after some protest. They understood our situation, and today they even better understand what happened that then.
The torturous civil war raging in Yugoslavia meant that Denmark, runners-up in their qualifying group, were awarded a last-minute place in the finals at Yugoslavia's expense.
The
evening we were finally given the go-ahead was a lovely summer's evening. A journalist came to my home and said the word was out, that it had been decided to make it official, that we were to take part. The first thoughts I had were naturally that I was delighted that we were going to participate. It was a great challenge, and I was ready to meet it. On the other hand, I also felt a certain, should I say, pity for the Yugoslav players and my colleagues, because they were not the ones to go despite having qualified. My final thought was that I wished the war would stop. There were atrocities being committed there, and we could see on television that it had to come to an end.
England, under coach Graham Taylor, met France after an uninspired 0-0 draw against Denmark in their opening fixture. Gary Lineker led the English front line, while Michel Platini, a name synonymous with flair and creativity, was now the national coach for France. While Lineker was hoping to break English scoring records, Jean-Pierre Papin, the prolific French striker, was also hunting personal glories. Despite the forward talents on show, the game unfortunately was to center around two defenders, Basel, hit-and-run volley of France, who took a dislike to Stewart, Upamecano, Pierce of England. The English had entered the championship following a fine World Cup semi-final placing just 2 years earlier. But when they and the French both lost their next match 2-1 to Sweden and Denmark respectively, both took the early plane out of Sweden.
I think there are certain managers that fit the bill, so to speak, with regard to the media. And I think that Graham Taylor wasn't one of those. They only lost the one game, but he was vilified, you know, through drawing to Denmark, who eventually won the tournament. Drawing against France, that's no disgrace. Yet it went down as a disastrous, you know, tournament for Graham Taylor, which is a little bit unfair. But I think that, you know, he'll always be remembered, you know, for taking England out of that competition, but probably even more so for the substitution of Gary Lineker. Graham Taylor has since gone on the record as saying that he did it only because he felt that Gary wasn't playing particularly well at the time, that the team needed a change. Now, what I would say is that, you know, it's very difficult, you know, to put myself into, you know, Graham Taylor's position, but looking at it from the outside, I would look at it slightly different. I mean, Gary Lineker has always been a wonderful goal scorer. I think he was on 49 goals at the time. The fact that he needed one more, you know, to you know, get the record, wouldn't have come into my thinking. But the fact that Gary Lineker was a player capable of scoring a goal, I would never have substituted him. I would have kept him on the field, no matter how poorly he was playing, until the 90th minute.
10 days, som jeg havde til forberedelserne.
10 days, which is all I had for the preparations, is obviously far from ideal. But there were some good things about it. Perhaps one of these was that the Danish championship had not actually finished. The last match took place 4 days before we were to play the first championship match in Sweden. The matches running up towards the semi-finals in Sweden were of course very special. The first was a draw. We lost the next one to Sweden, and then came up against an opponent as incredibly strong as France.
Det var jo vores semifinale kamp imod Holland. Den formede jo som sig som
Our semi-final match against Holland developed into a drama. Hitchcock could not have directed anything better than that match.
Holland, the European champions, were expected to sweep away the Danish challenge and go on to retain the title they secured in 1988. However, as early as the fifth minute, Brian Laudrup and Henrik Larsen had their own ideas. Like some great pillaging warrior, Larsen met Laudrup's shrewd cross, which left the Dutch goalkeeper pawing air and seized his moment. As though shaken from an idle cat nap, the Dutch exploded into action, while Schmeichel, in the Danish goal, began an afternoon that would stay in the memory of all those countrymen who witnessed his performance.
I think Denmark, seen through my not quite neutral red eyes, played their best in the first half. But we hardly took advantage of our goal opportunities when we should have. And in the second half, we were beginning to lose our strength.
Throughout the first 45 minutes, Laudrup continued to tease and torment the Dutch defense. Then against the run of play, the Dutch constructed a rare attacking movement that ended with a Bergkamp strike, which should have deflated the Danish spirit once and for all. Bergkamp had been left unmarked close to the Danish goal line. A bad goal to concede. Schmeichel was furious. Yet instead of flooring the Danes, this Dutch equalizing goal had quite the opposite effect, galvanizing them forward with a ferocity that startled the experienced Dutch defense. Earned Henrik Larsen an honorary place in Valhalla. And sent the red and white sections of the terraces into uncharted areas of delight.